Namaskaram. Good afternoon. My gratitude to Dr. Mesh and Dr. P. U. Krishnadas for having me here and enjoy the beauty of this place. I hope you can hear me, for certainly my voice is echoing back to me. But I hope you are able to listen what I'm saying. And I think I'm trying not to put you to sleep. And also I promise that perhaps I'll stop before you really feel the pangs of hunger towards the lunchtime. Well, friends, this whole morning, I think we have been hearing the words, at least the Bhagavad Gita management, right? At least these two words were kind of being said again and again by the speakers. And perhaps some of you got something out of it, or perhaps you must be waiting that something perhaps you will get out of it. Considering that this is an academic discussion, and I think as your chairman said in the beginning, that one need to be not so much worried whether the content of the Gita is perhaps not befitting an academic space, but perhaps it is an academic topic which we all can discuss. So considering that the Gita is something, a text which offers us for serious academic discussion, how do we approach it? How do we understand the text? But to give a break perhaps to the discussion which we had in the morning and until now, perhaps I would like to bring to your attention a slightly different topic. I hope all of you are able to listen to what I'm saying. Are you able to listen to me? Okay. So let's take a little break from what we have listened to until now. And I'll tell you why such a break perhaps will be helpful to understand the Gita itself better in a few minutes. And I think Dr. Umesh also mentioned about consciousness while he was speaking in the beginning. Well, the whole subject of consciousness studies, at least some of you would have heard about it, the whole subject of consciousness studies is a new discipline which brings in various kinds of disciplines, actually. It's a multidisciplinary topic which brings in psychiatry, psychology, neuroscience, literature, even physics, and even art. And it's interesting that why this topic has become so interesting in the last 10 years, the recent history of this discipline. Why such a topic has become so interesting and important is because of the kind of questions raised in this area. And one of the central questions is, what is the reason behind the experiences we had, right? We all have different kinds of experiences now, right? Perhaps an experience of boredom, perhaps an experience of perhaps a hope for the future, which is the near future is the lunchtime, and perhaps a hope for perhaps going out and seeing around if you have come from outside Kottapalam and Kerala. So we all are defined by a set of experiences. I hope you agree with me that, right? If I had to ask you to define yourself, how would you define? You would define yourself as perhaps addition or some of the experiences you would have at that point of time, right? So basically, we are defined by our experiences. So one of the central problems in consciousness studies is to understand how is an experience produced? Because some of you would know that as students of science and biology, we have been told that we are a result of the neural processes, right, that goes on in our brain. The neurochemical processes, the neurochemical functions of the brain result in what we experience and what we are. Well, much of biology believes that the brain is very important to define what is your experience. Some of you have the experience of distraction now, right? I mean, you turn your head that way, you turn your head this way. That's a very interesting kind of experience. It's called distraction, lack of attention. So the lack of attention comes from either the inability of the listener to understand what the speaker is thinking, or perhaps the atmosphere itself, perhaps which is not very conducive to listen. At any case, experience is something very important. At any moment, you are defined by your experience. Your identity is defined by your experience. So is it all solved if you take neuroscience and other subdisciplines which come from neuroscience, which says that you are a product of your brain. You are a product of the neurochemical processes and actions which are happening in the brain. Well, to some extent, perhaps this is a very interesting theory to begin with, and a lot of empirical data to also support it. But then, one of the central problems, I just told you about one problem, that how the brain creates experience. And the almost near to 100% believe that the brain produces, creates experience. The other central problem is, how do we understand the production of experience? Because if you consider the brain as more a quantitative organ, as an organ which is guided by chemistry, biology, and other physical processes, how can a physical process give rise to something which is uniquely qualitative, uniquely subjective? I hope I'm making some sense to you. How does the brain, which is a very biological organ, whose processes can be explained in quantitative realm, gives rise to something which is completely qualitative, and that results in experience of you and I? At any moment, our experience is what? I, right? The moment that any moment our experience is defined by a sense of I hope none of us would argue against that. Because even if you argue against that, that only proves that you're very sure that your basic experience is the experience of I. So I is a very intuitable experience. Even if you argue it out, it only proves its strong existence. So friends, what I wanted to share with you is that the most exciting problem in consciousness studies and cognitive sciences today is to explain how does the brain create our experience, or how do we understand experience? How does a quantity create a quality? How does physicality of the brain gives rise to the subjective nature of you and me? Now, what I want to explain to you further, perhaps in the context of either, is you would see that in such a trend of understanding something which is very complex, namely human mind and consciousness, the method which is taken is a method of binary. And what is that binary? Binary means a basic duality, you know, something which you explain with the help of the opposite or something which is not. So what is the basic binary here? The basic binary is of the subject and the object. The brain and experience, you and me. In fact, it's extremely interesting that in life, we are guided by such a binary of me and you, isn't it? At any time, we know that I have so much to say about myself, or so much that which belongs to me, or so much which is related to me, and then I have something which is other than me, which I consider as the other, the you. And the you can be something sometimes very pleasing, sometimes can be very displeasing, sometimes which can be very disturbing. But this is a basic binary, that me, my experience, and something which is other than me. It's interesting that even in the West, which is the seat of consciousness studies today, in the mainstream discussion, such a binary is taken as a method to understand. And I think the role of perhaps Indian philosophy, or many Eastern traditions, not just Indian philosophy, many other Eastern traditions, from China and Japan and so on, brings in perhaps the question of the need of questioning the binary. Is the method of binary an appropriate method to understand which is something complex? Can complexity be unraveled by the method of binary? And why I'm stressing this binary is because in our day-to-day living, in even the academic discussion, that binary rules the way we form arguments, the way we form positions, and the way we also dialogue with someone. The binary rules our thinking process itself. And that's why, and I think this such a binary is very strongly founded in the Western tradition. If you look at perhaps, I don't know whether you would find these names ringing a bell, names like Francis Bacon or René Descartes, who is a very famous, who was a famous mathematician turned philosopher, who talked about reason and emotion distinctly, and also kind of heralded continental philosophy in the West. And even take a person like William James. I'm sure many of you would have heard of William James, one of the proponents of psychology. And people like Antonio Damasio, who is one of the recent neuropsychiatrists, who is quite well known for his work on emotions. People tend to believe that reason or rational activity is something to be encouraged and emotional expressions are something to be controlled or ridiculed or even perhaps not talked about, pushed down. But in any case, what I wanted to bring to you, your attention, is that we have been always working on binaries, encouraging one and discouraging the other. In fact, the whole of academic space has been defined by the rule of the binary. And I think in the morning session itself, I remember at least one of the speakers said that emotions have to be controlled. We should not be emotional. And what does that mean? That we should always be rational agents. Is it possible to be always rational? Because are we always thinking in terms of reasoned arguments? In which case, how does our personality affect our day-to-day thinking and day-to-day living? What is the place of emotions? And this is where an interesting discovery, or I should say an interesting thinking has come in terms of neuropsychiatry and in terms of understanding consciousness. One is by Antonio Damasio, who talks about what is called the somatic markers. Somatic markers is a nice name which he gives for emotions. And in fact, his theory is that if you are good at emotions, you are good at decision making too. Because decision making, most of the time, is not a rational activity, or at least not completely a rational activity. You have several insights, you have several gut feelings, you have several intuitions which come in not as a product of just recent arguments, but as a result of your ability to watch, as your ability to see the subtlety, your ability to see the nuances, your ability to see the periphery and not just the mainstream. So this interesting concept of somatic markers, which he brings in, it says that unless you are able to develop your emotions, unless you are able to express your emotions in an effective manner, your decision making will be always at faulty spaces. It is this introduction which I wanted to give you. Before I think I'll say something about the Gita. Everybody is going to speak to you on the Gita. So I thought it's important to give a context to the importance and the value of this text. Well, friends, please listen to me. I hope this voice is not echoing and, you know, I'm not stopping you from listening to some of these ideas which I wanted to share with you. If you look at the Gita starts with a binary. Have you ever thought that what the binary is of the Gita? The Gita starts with the request of Arjuna to Krishna, why did you take me in between these two armies? And who are these two armies? The two armies, one which is belonging to my very clearly, and I can also see what belongs, what does not belong to me, and therefore I know what strategy I should use. So it's very interesting that the Gita begins with the binary, and all throughout this text, the attempt of the Gita is to break the binary and to show you something which is much more complete, something which is much more interesting than perhaps the boring limits of the duality, which is very much embedded in human experience. Friends, the work of Gita is an exercise on understanding human identity, human self. What are you? Who am I? How am I placed? Because the interesting aspect of this text and the questions which this quest raises is that, can you understand yourself in a squared space of yourself? Can you understand just by perhaps meditating along, reflecting upon yourself, talking about, always about yourself, right? I mean, sometimes you see that people can't talk about anything without a self-reference. Sometimes we also hear people who can't talk about anything without a reference to the other. So we either are influenced by the pushing of oneself or the pushing of the other. So the Gita is an attempt to break such a binary, and that's why it starts with this placement of the chariot between the two army of the Pandavas and the Kauravas, and to tell us that we are in a perpetual conflict. And who has created that conflict? No one has created the conflict. The conflict has been created by our mind. Because our mind is unaware of another method than being placed in the middle of two. Because there is also a sense of insecurity, right? Unless I know what the other is doing, I cannot define my own actions and reactions. So it's always important for me to see what is the other person doing. So the definition of your own self, your own actions, your own responses is many times defined by the other, what is other than you. Well, since the time is limited, I would share a few more ideas and perhaps talk. As I said, I would think personally that the attempt of this text is to define and also dissolve what is binary. The basic duality of you and the other, me and the other, the world, my world and the other world, and so on. How does it do? What is the exercise? What is the methodology which Gita enunciates to do this? It's amazing that there are lots of psychological techniques which are used in the Gita. And the first technique which is used is just ignore the source of your conflict. Many a times when we are in a conflict, when we are in a dilemma of unable to decide which option should we choose, what is our immediate response? The immediate response is of worry, right? W-O-R-R-Y. Or the inability to focus on what is needed, but a preoccupation on the nature of the problem itself. I hope people behind are smiling and sharing jokes on what I'm saying, because I see a lot of people having conversations unto themselves. I don't think that's a good time for this, so please listen to me. We are saying something interesting, right? So, and I need to hear what is the joke which you're sharing perhaps afterwards. So, the attempt of the Gita itself is to see how such a conflict can be dissolved. And the first attempt is to ignore or perhaps not to give attention to the source of the conflict, or to ignore the conflict itself. That is not of a natural situation itself. And this is where you will see in one of the earliest verses of the perhaps the second chapter or even the first chapter, it is said that Krishna just smiled. And when did he smile? When Arjuna was almost falling upon in his chariot. There's a beautiful description of Arjuna's inability to stand the decision which he himself has taken after a lot of thinking. There's a beautiful description of his body. There's a beautiful description of his mind. There's a beautiful description of even his instrument, which is his bow and arrow as a Kshatriya. He is supposed to be always holding his bow and arrow, you know, without shaking. Just as we are supposed to hold our pens without shaking when you write your exam. But when do you find your pen shaking? When you have to write your exam, right? Your pen shakes, your hand perspires a lot, then you can't hold it. So you see an Arjuna describing, but very interestingly, he is able to describe himself, what goes on in himself, with himself, and therefore why he has to flee that situation. And most often, those descriptions in the Gita are left out. People immediately go to the middle part of the second chapter and then see the philosophy. But I think it's extremely interesting to look at the tragic situation of this very successful, very magnificent character who is Arjuna. And if you would see Mahabharata, not just read the Gita, but if you read the Mahabharata itself, you would see that this guy is not just a simplistic guy. He knows how to solve problems. He knows what is the right response when you are in difficulty. But such a person, when he is brought in the middle of a binary, he falls and he doesn't know what to do. He literally falls down. And that is why Arjuna's state is described as Vishada. But then it's also said that Vishada leads to a certain state of existence which is considered as yoga. Friends, the whole of the text is to analyze the conflict which Arjuna goes through or went through at that particular time and see his mind. So the whole attempt of Krishna is not just a proselytizing speech to change him, not to just a prosaic way of explaining what the Gita is about, but helping him to see himself. It is like, you know, showing a torchlight onto his mind and showing what is going through Arjuna's mind. And if you would put the Gita as a nutshell, of course the most important teaching of the yoga Gita is the yoga, right? Because anyone who talks about the Gita, I think it would be surprising if they don't know the word yoga. We are not talking about just the Patanjali's yoga or the Raja yoga, but there is a very unique concept of yoga in the Gita, which is actually an attempt to see the complexity of the mind and the self-identity in a wholesome manner. Because the crux of the problem, according to Gita, lies in seeing a problem in a very wholesome manner, seeing a binary in a very wholesome manner, in a complete manner. And complete manner means it is a very unlimited manner. It cannot be binary. Binary is the basic vision, right? This and that is the basic two. But can you increase the periphery? Can you increase the number of nuances by which you understand a complex problem? This is the attempt of the Gita. And the Gita continues in the whole text in the range of the 18 chapters. Gita discusses about desire and the vacuumness which is in desire. Imagine all of us without having a desire. It will be very a great calamity, right? The basic desire of having to get up from this chair and go for lunch, if you don't have that desire, either you... But I guess I'm trying to say it loud so that you can hear what I'm saying. I know this mic is echoing. So the idea of the Gita or the idea of yoga itself is to give a different perspective to your vision. And the basic perspective is to give you a distance from where you are at that point either brings in a new way of looking at the human identity itself. Because at any point, you're an actor, right? Can you imagine any moment where you're not able to do anything at all? Can you think about a moment where you cannot, you don't do anything? Even at this point, you're doing an umpteen number of things, right? You're sitting in the chair, but either you're sharing a joke with a friend, or taking the phone and speaking, or perhaps doodling on the paper, or smiling to another person, and see what's happening. It's extremely difficult for us to stay in thought and action. Think about it. But the problem there is, when the moment comes for right action, you're unable to do the right action. I have seen many people failing miserably at interviews, but do they lack in talking? No, they talk all the time. They talk all the time, never short of words. But the right amount of talking is needed, they are unable to talk. Why is that? Because we are unable to do the right thing at the right moment. The Gita very interestingly talks about intricate theory that connects the agent, agency, and the mode of action. And it doesn't stop there. As I said, the Gita starts with sorrow and agonies of Arjuna, and then it talks about desire, and perhaps the empty space which is covered by desire, and then goes on to talk about the agent, agency, and action. And in this whole process, Gita talks about perhaps four or five important definitions for yoga. Gita brings in the idea of yoga as very important. One of the definitions of yoga is yoga karma sukhasana. Many of you would know that, right? Yoga is being good in what you do. Most of the time, we are good in what we don't do. Many times, we advise people what to do and how to do, right? And we know that we are not good at doing that. We are good advisors, but not good practitioners. According to Gita, it's not necessary that you have to preach to another person, but be good in what you are doing. Yoga karma sukhasana. And this would be a perhaps a superficial meaning, but it has very intricate meanings about the kaushala which it talks about, the kushala that it talks about. It is dexterity in action. Dexterity in action also means the ability to reduce any kind of distraction. And this story has been always narrated in the Mahabharata. When you do something, you be that. Nothing else. Nothing else is there. Only what you do. And this is something which is the ability to perhaps balance the reactions
automatically
from the opposites which we encounter all the time, right? Most of the time we encounter this. Good people, bad people, good person, bad person, nice person, bad person, good lunch, bad lunch, hot climate, cold climate, right? Success, failure, is good for me, bad for me, etc., etc. We all the time are kind of embroiled in the binary of it. So can you keep an equanimity? It's not necessary that we ignore what are the opposites, but because by ignoring the opposites, you are not being sensitive to what is happening, but can we bring in a balance of mind? And this balance of mind is not talked about not only in the text of Indian tradition, but also Buddhist tradition, where equanimity is something which is extremely important. Another definition of yoga is samadhi atala buddhi. Again, many of you would have heard about it, which is, again, the ability to keep a meditative calm, even while you're in the midst of activity. Even while you're in the midst of activity, you have the secret space of peace, the secret space of settlement within you. And according to me, that is possible for anybody to discover such a space of quietude and calm inside, in spite of the activity which goes around you. Another definition of Gita, which I think is extremely important, is dukkha samyoga viyoga. Here, dukkha or dukkha is not to be just understood as sorrow, but any kind of duality. So I think the most important teaching of the Gita is to move away from duality, because any duality gives rise to displeasure and dissentiment for your identity. So the most important teaching of the Gita, I would think, is to move away from the duality and to seek freedom. So in that sense, can you be free? us to something which we discussed at the beginning, which is the importance of emotions. It's not getting rid of emotions, but using your emotions to live a life which is interesting, to live a life which is creative, and of course to live a life which is good for oneself, and of course a life which is good for the others. Thank you very much.